Adaptive strategies, models.
There are several strategies that a student can use. One of those includes developing of models, both using models and having students create models.
Teacher presents a large three-dimensional cell model depicting various structures for students to touch and examine.
So obviously, no one can really see a cell. I mean, what we see through a microscope, especially those inexpensive microscopes that they have, you know, most school systems, the kids might see a blurry blob on the other end. So most teachers will have cell models, many of which are three-dimensional, that students can look at and examine. So that works for the whole class, not just the student with visual impairments. Another activity that is very important for students that helps with concept development is actually building a model themselves.
Students are examining cell models constructed with a glue gun and placing objects within the model.
You can have a student create a model of a cell. For example, the teacher could provide a large piece of cardboard with a large ring drawn in glue, with a glue gun. And that's a very tactual membrane. So that would represent the cell membrane of the cell. And then provide the student with a variety of odd objects, caps, bottle caps, cotton balls, seeds, and other things. And each of those could become an organelle, one of those small parts of the cell.
Teacher and students gather around a model of a human skeleton.
Another activity that's a very typical activity in elementary school is understanding the human body. And one of the many, many activities in life sciences is understanding the difference between organisms that have backbones and organisms that don't. So some of the chordates. So we're chordates. A really fun activity for students would be creating a backbone, creating a model of a backbone.
Students examining models of vertebrae and exploring bags containing material to construct model backbones.
So what we do to model this is use either a pipe cleaner or a string, again, depending on the hand skills of the student and the length of backbone that we wish to model. We use macaroni and jelly lifesavers. So part of this is understanding that models represent something that we cannot easily touch ourselves and that people can't see. No one can see them.
I feel neat.
There are a number of concepts that I hope they'll come away with from building a model backbone. One is the idea that the backbone is composed of vertebrae, that in fact backbones have discs between the vertebrae, and that in fact our backbone encloses our spinal cord.
Students threading material onto pipe cleaners to construct model backbones.
One way we teach it is to in fact first have the students build a backbone that has no discs.
One student picks up a model backbone and holds it near her ear. Another builds a model with macaroni and jelly lifesavers, then holds it to his ear.
We grind it.
It was grind.
And then the students can pick up the backbone and wiggle it and hold it near their ears and hear the macaroni vertebrae rubbing and crushing and grinding against each other. Then we have them take off those macaroni and rebuild the backbone with discs. And then pick it up and again listen and bend it and twist it and think about the ways that their own back moves and compare that to the movement of the backbone that they've built. And explore the questions such as, what would happen if you didn't have discs in your back? And how is this model backbone like your own backbone? When students are learning about the traits and characteristics of different animals, one of the expectations within the curriculum is that they're able to identify differences among various species of animals.
Student at desk typing on laptop. Teacher asks a question.
Andy, have you located a hawk sound yet for us?
It's very difficult for a student who's blind to see the whole animal.
That's the mating call.
And we look at traits and characteristics. However, for a lot of students, it's beneficial if they can see actual animals.
Student and teacher examining taxidermied hawk.
That's not always possible. You can't get up close and personal with a tiger. Both here at Perkins and at the Science Museum, there's possible access for students to actually touch animals that have been taxidermied.
Illustration of four finch species with different and distinct beak shapes.
There's one very popular exercise that is common in teaching biology at the high school level, of course, is understanding Darwin and his studies with finches and how they evolve differently because of the shapes of their beaks, was influenced by what food was there. So we collect a number of birds from our instructional materials center and with varying kinds of beaks, and we allow the students to examine them.
Teacher and three students at lab table examining three taxidermy birds.
They are different species of birds.
And that may be the first time that a student, even that student might be 16, 18 years old, that may be the first time in high school that this blind student may have seen what a bird actually looks like. They may be able to understand or recognize auditorily the bird calls for a number of animals.
Right, and his wings, whoop, be careful.
But they may never have examined what a bird actually looks like in terms of its physical characteristics.